schedule a public hearing to receive input on the fiscal year 2017 school budget. And we'll ask Mrs. Overby to do the roll call.
Mr. Walker?
Here.
Dr. DeVault?
Here.
Ms. Flanagan? Ms. Maddox?
Here.
Mr. Milner?
Here.
Dr. Stanbaugh?
Here.
And Mr. Zay?
Here.
The first part of our session this evening is the budget work session, and Dr. Cotton is going to present some of the budget background.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I don't have a presentation to share at this time, but I just want to update you on where we are with the process. I have been meeting with different advisory groups. I had to reschedule a couple of those due to our snowstorm that we had unexpectedly there, but I did meet with the student advisory and the teacher advisory, as well as the support staff advisory group yesterday, so that we made all those up to get their list of priorities. What I plan to do on Thursday at our board meeting, we have a work session scheduled, and what I'd like to do is provide some additional background at that meeting, and then I'll ask the board members to do some ranking as well of the different priorities that have developed through the budget process. So we'll do that Thursday during the work session, and then I'll have some additional updates at that time. Madam Chair, that's really all that I want to share this time, so I know we're opening this up for public comment.
We will officially begin the public hearing at 5:32 p.m. And the public hearing is a time for public comment, and that means that we are here to listen to what you have to say, not to engage in a question and answer period or a debate. Upon arrival at the podium, please state your name, your subject matter, and the district in which you live. By coming to the podium, you have agreed that you will exhibit respect for the board and its members, as well as the staff and students of Henry County Public Schools. You will receive the same consideration from the board. Please keep your comments to 3 minutes. Are there those who wish to address the board tonight? Okay, Ms. Hart.
Well, I'm Dorothy Carter, and I'm from the Reed Creek District, and I'm here representing the Henry County Education Association, which, of course, is more than just our teachers. We have many concerns that have to be considered as we prepare, as you prepare, this budget for 2016-17. There are concerns that probably need to be addressed not just internally, but publicly as well. I'm going to give you a list, and then I'm going to go through. They're not in any order of particular importance, but I'm going to go through and just elaborate a little bit. Teachers have been told there are no funds for teacher professional development this current school year since August of 2015. Teachers have been told there are no funds for field trips second semester, as those funds were spent first semester. Coaches have been told to limit their team sizes to the number that can attend away games on one bus, even though VHSL rules allow more students on the team. Class sizes are too large. They've grown to 30 to 35 students for many teachers, including core teachers of SOL classes. So we appear to be understaffed. Inclusion classes have as many as one half of the population as inclusion students. Our schools lack enough special education teachers. Cafeteria staff are woefully underpaid. There are often not enough substitutes. Step raises have been frozen for 4 years, and we're now being told they'll be frozen for another year while the salary scale continues to be adjusted to be competitive with nearby school districts. At the superintendent's roundtable, we were told that the steps from years 1 through 5 or 6 or 7 might also be adjusted this coming year, so that Henry County Public Schools remains competitive with the surrounding counties. All of these issues affect more than the educators in our system. They ultimately affect our students. When teachers cannot access the funds that are earmarked for professional development and additional college classes, that makes a difference to the students. Teachers need to be current with the latest information for their fields. HCEA inquired about this issue in October, and we were told that funds were depleted early because so many had requested them early on, and not as many dollars had been reserved this year for this fund. We knew of teachers, however, who had been denied access to those funds as early as August. So that raised a lot of questions in our minds about how those funds could be depleted so early in the school year. Field trips are an important part of learning for students. Yet before December, teachers were told that no more trips were likely to be approved as that money had been depleted. Learning outside the classroom walls is important for our students. These are the trips that spark academic success, that they're the sparks that foster a desire to learn, that stimulate the imagination and produce creative thought. We've been encouraged as teachers to produce young innovators, but we aren't being given the tools to help mold those young people. VHSL sets numbers that can participate on a team, yet there are reports that some coaches have been told to limit the number of those students on the team so that only one bus has to go to an away game. Sports teams are vital to education. I heard Mr. Milner say this at one of, I think, the December board meeting. They support academics while giving young people purpose in life. They teach them teamwork. They promote relationships. These are things that our youth need, and we're not sure why they're being limited. There is speculation among faculty and staff that some of these funds are going toward the unbudgeted renovations at Bassett High School for Bengal Tech. It may or may not be true. The budget is not transparent enough for us to know for certain. However, we do know that savings have to occur in order for unbudgeted capital outlay events to occur, and we know that those renovations were not budgeted. HCEA is not discouraging doing what is right for students, but we are concerned when vital programs are cut. Cafeteria workers have been promised raises for the upcoming budget, and those are long overdue. How those workers live on their salaries without some type of public or private assistance, I don't know. Many of them only make about $500 a month. Some of them are working longer hours than they're really supposed to work. They're providing 3 meals for our students a day. Anyone who cooks knows that to prepare 2 to 3 meals a day for even 25 to 35 students, that would take a lot of a teacher's time. We as teachers don't have time to do that. We need these staff people. They are vitally important to our faculty. I'm going to do something we don't normally do with HCEA right now, but I'm going to talk about one school. And I'm going to talk about the situation in one school because it's soon going to be a situation at another school. At Magna Vista High School, Warrior Tech was established as a school within a school. In Warrior Tech, typically those teachers who teach 2 classes have 100 students all year long. And what has happened over the years is that on the outside of Warrior Tech, classes are increasing in 30 to 35 students this year. And so we have teachers who are teaching 150 to 180 students all year long as compared. So we've developed an inequity. Now, I'm not saying that what's going on in Warrior Tech is wrong. We're not saying that at all. But what we are saying is there needs to be a different formula when deciding how many teachers the building needs. They need to decide how many are needed for Warrior Tech, then there needs to be a decision for how many are needed outside of Warrior Tech. And that will soon become an issue at Bengal Tech as well if we look just at numbers that are at that one school. Warrior Tech teachers are supposed to have 2 planning periods a day. Most of them do, well, some of them do. Some of them are teaching 3. There's some rumor that they're all going to teach 3 next year. Right now, those teachers who have two periods a day are often used as substitutes when we're short. And not just for 45-minute increments, like all the rest of us have been asked to do it from time to time, because it does happen. But they've been asked to do for a whole block. Now, if Warrior Tech teachers need two blocks a day for the planning and the extra projects and things that they do, then they need to have that planning time that is uninterrupted. They should not be looked at as someone who can, oh, you've got an extra planning, you can substitute. The final thing I want to address is the issue of teachers' salaries. When our classroom sizes began to increase under Dr. Jackson, they never shrunk again. And in fact, it seems that in some of our schools, they're increasing even more. An absolutely brilliant teacher told me just recently that there was no way he could guarantee all his kids could pass SOLs anymore. Because with 35 students in a classroom, he didn't feel that he was giving each of his students enough individual attention. And that's certainly a concern. We have an English teacher with 90 students this semester. In fact, I know we have other English teachers with more than 72. That's against the code of Virginia. The one that has 90, she told me what was going on. I said, you know, we can push that through HCA. That violates the code of Virginia. And that teacher told me no, because these kids have to have this class. It's not fair. They should wait another year. But it's still problematic. It's an SOL class. It's a problem. So two things need to happen here. Class sizes need to shrink, and teachers need to be adequately compensated. I'm going to give you a comparison scale. I'll hand it to Melinda. This is much the same as the scale that we have in the budget every year. It comes from this information comes from the VEA. I shared it with Dr. Cotton earlier. It came out in November this year. And you will see the salaries compared with Danville, Franklin, Martinsville, Patrick, and Pennsylvania, just like we do in our budget every year. However, unlike the comparison that is compiled for our budget, I put an asterisk beside the years where we're still not matching up. Compared to Pennsylvania County, we're doing really well. I would not want to work in Pennsylvania County. Compared to Patrick County, we do well in 2 years, 25 and 30. However, other counties are still doing better than ours. Years 10 through 25, Danville City pays more. Years 5 through 20, Martinsville City pays better than Henry. In years 5 and 15 through 30, Franklin County does better than Henry. While we're still trying to adjust our salaries on the salary scale according to the best recommendations, we're still being left behind. At Superintendent's Roundtable, we were told that steps 1 through 5 and maybe 6 or 7 would be adjusted again. And frankly, we object to that. That's going back to what we were trying to get away from before. We have followed the VAS model, except for beginning salary. The VAS recommendation was that starting teachers would get $39,000. Right now, they're getting more than that. But that new model could show that. Suggestion, $39,400 is still competitive. Without moving the other steps. U.S. average salary for teachers is $56,600, according to NEA rankings and estimates of school statistics. Our budget from this past year reveals that we're at an average salary of $44,050. The rankings and estimates also reveal that Virginia ranks number 29 among all states in average salaries. You can see our salaries are probably at the bottom of the whole nation. And it's commendable that Dr. Cotton is trying to adjust our salary scale. It's important that we are equitable, competitive with surrounding counties. However, it's evident that while the adjustments are occurring, the scale is still behind some of our fiercest competition. And while it's being adjusted, because the steps are not moving, employee morale about salaries is low. There's discouragement, even among young teachers. I had a young teacher say to me yesterday, she feels like she's just going to have to invest somewhere else because she feels like she's never, ever going to reach the top of the scale. And she has a lot of years ahead of her, but when she sees that scale hasn't moved now, it won't move for 5 years. That's discouraging. So who's to blame? Well, that's a complex issue. Some of you may know that yesterday I went to lobby day. They revealed to us, the VEA revealed to us, that we're now 41 in the nation among state support of public education. And that doesn't rank us very well. There were a couple of encouraging things. There were four bills in to give teacher salary raises within this coming year. One on the House side, two on the Senate side. We'll see how that goes by crossover. Our localities to blame too. When they left $1 million out of the budget last year, when the courthouse was paid for, I remember sitting in the meeting, they said, well, we left that out because we may want to do something. And I sat there and I thought, well, you could give a third of it to fully fund Henry County Public Schools. You'd have two-thirds of $1 million left, you know, to take care of that, but they didn't do that. And frankly, then, of course, there is the feeling among our staff that this board, anxious to fulfill some of its own projects, also overlooks teacher employee salaries and other needs. We recognize the difficulty of our local school board, though. We do that. And we're thankful for the 100% health insurance. That's a bonus. But there are still those who feel that there's more that could be done for employee salaries. So, again, this year I stand before you, as I seem to do every other year for several years now, and I'm asking you to do your best. Our teachers and employees give their best to our students every single day, and they deserve our best back.
Are there other speakers to say? Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is James Whitlow, Jr. I'm with the Ridgeway District. I'm a special education paraprofessional at George Washington Carver Elementary School. First, I'd like to thank you for last year acknowledging and giving the paraprofessionals a 5% increase, the special education paraprofessionals. We greatly appreciate that. In this year's budget, I understand there's another 5% listed as well. There's still like a $2,700 gap between a special education paraprofessional and a preschool paraprofessional. And that's a pretty big gap. Special education paraprofessional, if you look at the pay scales, you can see that that is there. A special education paraprofessional, you know, on a daily basis, they run the chance of getting kicked, hit, scratched. I can actually show you some scratches from today. it's a job that a lot of people don't want. As a matter of fact, we had one out today, and we could not get a sub. I understand somebody signed up for it and then realized where we was at, what class it was, and decided not to take. So it is a job that it takes a special person to do. I'm here to ask two things. I'm here to ask you to please support that 5% for this year. And I think that is a nice token and a step in the right direction of getting us back to where we need to be. But I also ask that you consider doing the same thing for the next year of budget. A little at a time would get us back to where, at least even with a preschool paraprofessional, and then we do just as much as they do, and we run a greater risk. And I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Goodman. Are there other speakers to address the board? Thank you, Mr. No other speakers, we will close the public hearing at 5:50. Are there matters from the board to be discussed tonight?
I just had a question. It was mentioned by one of the speakers from the floor that our budget spending might not be transparent enough. I know we get every single month in our minutes a line by line down to the cent of what is spent by this board. Is that available to the public?
Yes, all of that's okay. Available online.
So I just want to make sure, I mean, I know we can see that. So that,
yeah, everything is
tough to imagine being more transparent.
Correct me if I'm wrong. All of that's in the public board docs is available to everyone.
I'd like to comment that the Commonwealth of Virginia is 41st out of 50 states. Support of public education. Commonwealth of Virginia can do a whole lot better than that. That's my comment.
Are there any comments from the board? If not, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn the meeting.
So moved.
Second.
So moved and seconded to adjourn the meeting, the public hearing.